to the What Bitcoin Did podcast.
Hi there from Los Angeles. How are you all? Welcome to the What Bitcoin Did podcast brought to you by Kraken. I'm your host, Peter McCormack, and today I've got a different interview. I've got Marc Weinstein, who was featured heavily in the Netflix documentary about the Fyre Festival. But before that, I've got a message from my show sponsors. So let's talk about my new sponsor, Kraken, again. The best exchange in the business. They've signed up for a long-term deal with me, sponsoring the podcast. And I've submitted my KYC. I'll let you know about this before. I submitted it and I was approved in under 2 hours, which was pretty cool. I got fully verified for tier 3 within 2 hours. And at the end of each month, when I audit the podcast, do my stats and balance my accounts, I always have a certain amount of Bitcoin I need to buy or sell to either pay people or to get paid myself. For example, some of my sponsors pay me in Bitcoin. So I do this whole balancing thing. So at the end of the month, I'm going to be using Kraken for this. I'm going to be telling you about my experience, reporting back on what happened. But I also want to hear from you. It'd be great if some of you got in touch and tell me which exchanges you use and why. Are you using Kraken? Are you previously a customer of Kraken? If not, let me know. Get in touch. Would be great to hear from you. I've got a direct lead into the team so I can feedback anything you send to me. DMs are open on Twitter or you can email me on hello@whatbitcoindid.com. So if you're thinking about Kraken, if you think about returning to them and you want to find out more about what they're doing, head over to kraken.com, which is kraken.com. And let's also talk about BlockFi and their new announcements. They recently launched crypto interest accounts, which definitely sparked a whole bunch of conversations. So people got in touch with me. So people reached out to me on Twitter. People have been reaching out to them direct as well. They've also started responding to some of the questions. So if you check out their blog, they've written an introduction to rehypothecation, which you can check out at blockfi.com/blog. But what about these interest accounts? Well, BlockFi are the only provider offering compound interest on crypto deposits, which is similar to a high interest savings account. They are offering the highest interest rate on BTC and ETH in the market. You earn your interest in your deposited currency. So if you deposit BTC, you earn BTC. There are no lock-in periods for your deposits and client assets are custodied by Gemini, who recently announced their digital asset insurance coverage and completion of its SOC 2 Type 1 security compliance review of its exchange and custodian platform. If you want to find out more, head over to blockfi.com, which is BlockFi.com. Okay, so onto the interview. And as I mentioned in the intro, this is a different one. I met with Marc at Token 2049 in Hong Kong, but I had also previously been introduced by a mutual friend of ours and said, look, did I want to interview him? Marc's now involved in Bitcoin and crypto. So I said, yeah, definitely. Let's meet up. So I agreed to meet up with him in LA and do an interview. But while Marc now works in the industry, I'd only just recently watched both the Netflix and Hulu documentaries about the festival. And with Marc heavily featuring in the Netflix documentary, I really just wanted to talk about what happened. And he was cool with that, which is great. I thought this interview was fascinating, as we get to clear up some of the inaccuracies in the documentaries. And also Marc gets to tell me a bunch of things that weren't covered or things I didn't know about. So if you have watched the documentary, you might find this interesting. If you haven't, you might want to watch it first. We do also get into Bitcoin and crypto, and we compare what happened at Fyre to some of the stupidity of the ICO bubble, which happened in 2017. And we talk about how media works and the stresses and pressures which can come your way in life. So this was also the first time I recorded an interview outside, which was cool. And you might hear some birds tweeting in the background or planes going overhead. But yeah, hope you enjoy the interview. I'm leaving LA tomorrow. I'm heading out to Denver, then off to Austin, back to New York, and then home. I'll be recording a whole bunch of interesting interviews over the next few days, so I can't wait to get them out to you. I also just want to say a big thank you to all the emails, DMs, and public support I've received recently. The show's been getting a bit of pressure, but I do really appreciate anyone who gets in touch and tells me they enjoy the show and they like my work, so thank you so much. And if you do want to support the show, you can head over to my website, go to www.whatbitcoindid.com, click on the support section. There's a whole bunch of things you can do there. And yeah, I hope you enjoy the interview. If you've got any questions about it, feel free to reach out to me. My email address is hello@whatbitcoindid.com.
Like, prep in his notebook about this.
Well, usually I do. Usually I have like loads of questions. I'm already prepped, but it's a really tough one with this one because I know the story.
Yeah.
And it's just so many interesting like avenues to go in. And one of the problems I have when I have my questions ready is that I'm looking at the questions, I'm not listening to the person.
Yeah.
And I think in this one, I just want to ask the questions, listen to you, and then kind of work my way through it. I mean, obviously, you know this is a 90-95% Bitcoin podcast, occasional other crypto things. You know, I very rarely touch outside of Bitcoin, unless there's a loose connection. I did the interview with, say, Ross Ulbricht's mum because of the Bitcoin connection, but we didn't really talk about Bitcoin.
Yeah.
But then, obviously, we have a mutual friend who got in touch and said, Pete, do you want to interview Marc Weinstein from the Fyre Festival? And I'm like, I've literally just watched Netflix. I've just watched Hulu. Hmm. Yes, of course. It's not crypto. And in my head, I'm like, well, how do I justify this? And I don't want to, because I think there's enough in this that people hopefully will enjoy it, learn something from it. And look, even if they don't, they can just skip an episode. I do 9 a month, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So let's set it up. Let's do the crypto connection first. Okay. We might not even like align there, so we might just have to move on quickly. But let's do it anyway, so we've got it.
Okay. So what's the crypto connection here?
Yeah.
So where do I start? So basically, I have a finance background, worked in investment banking for a couple of years. Never really wanted to be on that traditional finance path. Came up studying economics during the financial crisis, and it kind of changed my views on how economics works and how the machine works. And when I quit banking, I started my first company, which was called Tinco. And we were creating a private market alternative to inflation-linked securities issued by governments. And in hindsight now, looking back, like, you know, whatever, 5 years, I realized that it was all about sound money, because we thought that there might be some kind of inflationary environment in the US dollar because of all of the monetary easing that was happening. And worked on that for about a year and a half with my partner before we realized, one, we were competing with banks in probably the most competitive lending environment in the history of credit. Two, our minimum viable product was a $10 million loan backed by receivables and inventories of fast moving consumer goods. And so we partnered with a lending company that ended up going bankrupt 2 months later, and realized that, you know, the challenge was probably too insurmountable for us to create this new asset manager without a track record and in that type of environment. So moved on. But right when I finished that company, I discovered Bitcoin. This was at the end of 2013. And the store of value thesis, or really the digital gold thesis, resonated with me, because I felt and still feel that, you know, we might experience some kind of sovereign debt crisis in the near future. So that's when I discovered Bitcoin. Price was at around $600. 4 months later, it dropped to $200. I think Mt. Gox happened. And I basically said, all right, I'm going to forget about this. It's either going to be a zero or a 10,000x. And so forgot about it. Decided to move into a totally different industry, the music industry, and we can talk about how I got there. And worked on that for a number of years, started my own festival company, which I sold at the end of 2017. And through the process of selling it, I started thinking about Bitcoin again. And this was like January of 2017. And I looked at the price, and for the first time since I had last checked, it was profitable investment. It was like $900 a coin or something. And I was like, this is crazy, but I have this intuition that Bitcoin's going to go through the roof. It was either like Trump's election or just the psychological barrier of $1,000 again. And I really didn't have any justification. And so I was like, okay, I need to figure out why I have this sense that Bitcoin price is going to appreciate. And so I started doing all this research. And all of a sudden, Bitcoin price was at $2,000 and then $4,000. And I was like, fuck, I missed it. And I kept thinking, like, I missed it. But then I said, you know what? I have this small investment that I made. Why don't I, you know, I didn't miss it. Why don't I use that and just keep learning? And so I started researching more and more, discovered Ethereum, invested into Ethereum with some of the Bitcoin. And then I discovered ICOs, and we can talk about that.
Yeah, ICOs are not going to go down well on this podcast. And even for me, do you know what? Like, I don't even think we need to get into the debate on that.
Yeah, no, not at all. I don't think it's a worthwhile argument. I mean, I think the jury's out on a lot of those already. But, you know, that's where I started deploying some ETH, and then just kept learning and studying as much as I possibly could about the space. And of course, got so deep down the rabbit hole that I was like, I need to do this full time.
Cool.
And I've been doing that ever since.
Right. So we've covered crypto.
Yes, that's crypto. We could talk more about it. Hopefully I can be on here one day for that.
Yeah, well, possibly. But okay. So interestingly, the Fyre Festival for me is really recent, because I've watched both documentaries in the last 3 months.
Mm.
But actually, it's quite old for you, right?
Yeah, it's definitely getting a bit old. But the festival was May 2017.
Right, okay.
So I started working on the festival in like the first week of April 2017.
Right, okay. So what the fuck, man? Like, okay, look, so my first question is, and there's so many I've got. So I've watched both documentaries.
Mm.
You lived it.
Yes.
Which is the most accurate documentary?
So it's not fair for me to say.
Okay.
I didn't watch the Hulu documentary. Basically, Hulu asked me for an interview. After I had already done the interview with Chris Smith, the director of the Netflix documentary, which wasn't, you know, associated with Netflix at the time. This was like September 17. I think it was just Vice when he was recording. And I had heard rumors that they had Billy on as, you know, as an interview guest. And I decided that if they had paid Billy, that I wouldn't want to work with them. So I spoke to them and I asked, I was like, did you pay Billy for the interview? And they were like, no, we didn't pay him for the interview. Well, did you pay Billy at all? Yes. So it turns out Hulu bought his life rights, which means they, I believe it means they own anything that he says in relation to this or not in relation to this or rights throughout the rest of his life.
Okay.
So
it's interesting that you chose not to watch it though. So I've watched it, and the biggest difference between the two, they tell the same story, is the way Fuck Jerry are painted. You know, they're painted in a really bad light in the Hulu documentary.
Yeah.
Did they have a connection to the Netflix documentary?
Yeah, so as I said, you know, when Chris first asked me to interview, it was just Vice.
Right.
And then I think as he was going down the path trying to find new content, he connected with the Fuck Jerry team, with Mick, the CEO, and they had all of this footage, right? And they had been close to it. So they came on, and I believe that in the credits, they're executive producers or just producers. I don't exactly know. But they definitely helped, you know, helped Chris in gathering interviews, getting content for the Netflix documentary. I think that's really the extent of it.
Right,
but
okay.
It's actually funny. When I spoke to the production company that did Hulu, they brought up Fuck Jerry. And they were like, well, you did the Netflix documentary. What do you feel about, you know, doing something that is going to enrich people that promoted the festival? And I just felt, you know, these were two really different things we were talking about. Like, Billy's in jail for wire fraud. You know, he's in jail for faking investment documents. A lot of what he did on social media is morally questionable. But I think it's definitely a little bit of a different scope between the Fuck Jerry team and Billy.
It's funny how external people will paint a narrative of you or decisions you make without knowing your own intentions. They choose your intentions.
Yeah.
I'm literally living that right now at the moment. I've got people telling me I've used Bitcoiners to promote my podcast, and now I'm shilling shit coins, or that I'm only doing things for money, and all kinds of accusations which aren't true. You've probably lived a worse version of that, a much worse version, right? What's that like?
Yeah, I mean, it's I don't know. Like, I don't know if it's been that bad. I think I've become kind of immune to it in a lot of ways. I think you just keep doing you, and you know your own intentions, and no one really is able to figure that out, right? And like, you're creating content that you want people to listen to. I was trying to produce a music festival, right? Trying to do my job. So I don't really think about it that much, to be honest.
Right, okay. When did you last speak to Billy?
Ooh, probably spoke to Billy in May 2017, right after the festival, and then never spoke to him again. I sent him an email, you owe me this amount of dollars, this is for the record, you know, please let me know if you'll be able to make payment, and never heard from him again.
And I guess you never will or will never want to? Or?
I hope not.
Right, okay.
If I hear from him again, it might, you know, it might be for something that I don't really want to talk about. I don't know.
All right, so let's unpack this. You started work on the Fyre in April 17.
Yeah, so I was introduced to Billy about probably the last week of March. And I mentioned this in the documentary, how I kind of had heard about the festival months prior, and me and some friends in the industry basically laughed when Ja Rule presented it, because we felt, you know, this is a really challenging undertaking to do a festival anywhere. I'd done a festival on Governor's Island in New York, as an example, and, you know, the logistics of producing on an island, even one that's 20 minutes ferry ride from New York City, is crazy. And they were doing it on, you know, in the Bahamas, which means you need to ship all of your production equipment there, all of your food, everything. And so we kind of laughed And then fast forward 2 months later, and the promo video comes out. I think this was like January 17. And friends are messaging me, hey, have you seen this Fyre event? You know, do you want to go? And people want to go. And all of a sudden it's sold out. And I was connecting with my friend Max, who produced the commercial and or the promo video. And I was like, so what's the deal? You know, are these guys real or is this kind of BS? And he's like, well, no, they're real. They paid all of these models to do this promo video, and they sold out the festival. And selling out a music festival in a first year is like, you know, it's an incredible undertaking. Obviously, we know they did it on, you know, on some lies, but it's still, you know, at the time, it seemed like, wow, these guys really know how to market. And so didn't really think about it again. 3 months later, my friend who works in venture capital called me and he said, hey, you know, we're looking at this company. It's called Fyre App. They're changing the way that talent gets booked in the music industry. We're really excited about it. We're going to invest. Submitted an LOI for $20 million. And was like, they're producing this festival to promote the app, but they need help with logistics. Can I connect you to the CEO? And I was like, sure. At this point, I had seen, you know, multiple touch points and was like, okay. So I get on a call with Billy at the end of March. We have a chat. Then I get on a second call with him and Joe Rule. We have another conversation. And then they're like, okay, well, if you want to do this, let's fly you down to the Bahamas so we can meet. Actually, I was supposed to fly down to New York. And then at the last minute, they changed it to the Bahamas. So I flew down to the Bahamas and I was supposed to meet with Billy. And we kept trying to connect. But instead, I ended up meeting with his right hand, who's not in either documentary. Gentleman who worked in private equity at a multi-$100 million fund for a number of years, very legit operator. And we spoke about what my role would be. And basically they needed help with logistics. And so we shook hands on a deal. I flew back to LA to pack my bag, got on my first phone call for Fyre, having signed my contract. And it was like kind of classic, you know, first year festival stuff. This bill hasn't been paid. This shipment's late, you know, things changing, a lot of moving parts. And I remember getting off the call and being like, wow, this is a mess. And not so much of a, this is a mess, like this is never going to happen, but this is a mess, like, or do they have enough money to pay for this? And so I called the guy that I had negotiated my deal with. And I basically said, I think we should renegotiate terms. And he was like, basically F you, take it or leave it. And I was kind of like, okay, you know, all expense paid trip to the Bahamas for 1 month, the potential to work on, you know, if we pull this off, this could be one of the biggest festivals, you know, of recent memory, maybe ever, not by attendance, but by just like the buzz around it. And I thought, okay, I'm just going to go down. So I flew down first weekend in April and the rest is in the documentary.
Okay. So at the point you're contracted, how much time is between the point you've signed a deal and the festival is meant to happen?
4 weeks.
4 weeks?
4 weeks, yeah.
Oh, right.
So I'm really in the documentary way more than the amount of time that I spent on the festival. But I think it just shows, you know, I think most of the producers were on board maybe max 8 weeks before the show.
Right, because it gives the impression that you were involved a lot earlier.
Yeah.
Right. So there's 4 weeks. Okay. Let's talk about
which is, by the way, another interesting thing about how media works.
Yeah.
Right. Like the perception of the documentaries, both of them versus what actually happened is, you know, and I love Chris, the director. But you know, there's definitely bits missing and there always will be when you have a story to tell.
I mean, the overriding thing that I think for you that comes across is that you're stuck between a rock and a hard place in that you won't be paid if you leave.
Yeah.
Yet you have a duty to try and help fix it.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's go back a step. You've run your own festival before.
Yeah.
How many people were at that festival?
So my first one was 5,000 attendees.
Okay.
I work with a company now called Prime Social Group. We've done festivals up to like 25,000 attendees, multi-day stuff with camping.
But the one you organize, say the 5,000,
mm-hmm.
1 day, 2 day?
1 day in New York City.
So mm-hmm. 1 day, 5,000. Music festival.
Food. It's called 90s Fest.
90s
food,
Fest.
Sponsorship, right. Music, logistics.
Full package.
The whole works.
Travel and everything.
Exactly.
Okay. How long did that take from idea to the event?
About a year and a half.
Knowing what you know,
mm-hmm.
What's the best time you think you could now redo that in? Could you do it in 6 months, 3 months?
I think that we would probably, for you, you can get something done faster. You just have to pay more.
Okay.
But even then, I think you really need 6 months to produce a festival.
See, I see there's a couple of things. There is the getting the stuff, like the stuff you need on site.
Yeah.
That's, like you say, you can pay. If you need water or vodka or beds, yeah. You can pay. Yeah. There's a price you can pay. But then the logistics of having the right people coordinate an event doesn't yeah. feel like something you can rush, because you have to have teams who know what they're doing at specific points on the site. You know, you've got security, you've got, I guess, people looking after bands. You've got yeah. so many different things that I guess that's kind of different.
Well, typically, I think the way that I think about music festivals is you start with a venue. So the venue is the absolute most important thing that you could possibly have.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't have the right space, then the festival's not going to work. An example of that is, again, going back to Governor's Island. You know, we produced our first festival in Brooklyn, right in the heart of Williamsburg. And then our second one moved to Governor's Island. And it changes everything, even just the attendees. Like, some people just don't want to go on an island, right? And so venue is crucial. And I think that, at least in the Netflix documentary, and I really should watch the Hulu one, you're right, but in the Netflix documentary, I think they do a good job of showing that they never had the right venue from the beginning. You know, they announced before they had a venue confirmed. And that's a really big no-no. The second is then you book your talent. Because most of the time, if you have a first-year festival, even if you're trying to sell a dream like these guys were, you need good artists to support that dream. And so by the time that's done, you've paid 50% deposits for your talent. You've put down your 50% deposit for your venue. And now you need to build out your marketing plan, or you're probably doing that simultaneously. So you start building out your marketing plan. You start hiring the team to get all the logistics in order. And then you announce.
And with the festival or festivals you've organized, what are the most painful lessons that you've learned in doing that?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think nothing ever works out the way you expect it to. You're constantly putting out fires.
Ironically,
yeah. It's a labor of love, you know, because when you launch like a tech company, right, you can launch an MVP and it can have bugs, you know, and you can relaunch your beta. When you're doing an event, there's no beta, right? There's no, even a walkthrough can't replicate what happens during the festival. So everything has to be completely buttoned up 100% when the guests walk through the door.
A walkthrough being a dry run of the festival.
A dry run of the festival. Just you and your production team walk through the venue, go through the checklist, make sure security's right, make sure that the exits are right. You know, make sure you have the right staff. Everybody knows where they need to be at what time. What's the run of show? You know, when do acts come on? When do they go off? What kind of sound engineering you need, doing a check of the sound on stage. So all of those things happen, you know, maybe the day of the festival in some instances. But even that can't replicate what's going to happen. And so, you know, I remember my first festival in New York. You know, it was little things like not leaving cones out the night before and then having a truck park right in the front of the entrance so that we couldn't even get things through. You know, the festival on Governor's Island, we had one of our sponsors bring a 26-foot truck with their full activation on board, and it couldn't clear the 13-foot height for the ferry, right? And this is something that we had been through for months with the sponsor and just got lost in communication. So we had to unload the truck, put everything onto the ferry, right? And that adds another 5 or 6 hours for build. And so things are constantly going wrong, and you just have to figure out, you know, you just have to figure out the best solution for them, because you don't get a second shot. It just happens.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you get to the Bahamas.
Mm-hmm.
You see everything. You see the... so who do you first meet? Who do you meet Billy straight away, or are you introduced to somebody else?
So I met Billy's right hand at the time, who, you know, Billy was also out raising money. He was doing the Fyre app thing. He would come to the island. He would leave the island. Typically, when he and his team were there, they were just, you know, fucking around on jet skis, having a good time, hanging out at the Grand Isle by the pool, you know, doing work, but they were kind of inaccessible to most of us. They were super busy. So, you know, I met some of the other production staff. There were probably around 8 people that were living on the island full time by the time I had arrived.
And amongst the group of people there, were there any people that you formed, like, became allies because you thought, okay, you know what you're doing, you're a good person, yeah, you've got your shit together, and there's other people that you're maybe like, you're a joker, I can't rely on you at all?
Yeah, well, I mean, I having thrown festivals before and being a first-time festival producer coming from an entirely different industry, you know, there's a level of arrogance that one has when you get into this space, because it's like, oh, I've been in finance, I worked in investment banking, you know, I'm smart, I get it. And then you realize, holy shit, this is really challenging. Because it seems like such a simple business, right? You book the talent, you know, you sell the tickets, and then everybody shows up and the festival happens. And it's just really not like that. And so when I got to the island, I think what I saw happening and what really ultimately happened was you had this kind of this tiering where you had the main Fyre staff, which, you know, of the names that are mentioned in the documentaries, Billy and Grant, and then a few others who no one on the production team really took seriously, but we needed them to actually communicate to fans when changes were being made, and we needed them to make key decisions, and we needed them to pay the bills. And then you had the 8 core production staff members at the time, which I think grew to like 25 as the month went on, who were kind of making the logistical decisions. And so we kind of formed this really strong bond, this camaraderie between the producers, who many of whom were all seasoned event producers, you know, have produced things like 3 Points in Miami, which is a huge festival. You know, the Gay Pride Parade in New York City. Mark Musters is in the documentary. He's done that for years. Obviously, Andy, who's in the documentary and Netflix, has done a number of events at scale. So you start building a camaraderie with, you know, with fellow producers and saying, and of course, throughout the weeks, we're all like laughing at the absurdity of it, extremely stressed, not sleeping, communicating with one another, trying to figure out where the pain points are, you know, and quite frankly, going back and forth on whether or not this event is actually going to happen.
Okay, so you first get to the island. Do you have a first meeting?
Yeah, we have a first meeting. So met all the production staff. I think we did one, by this time, I think we were doing a daily where Billy would come in and we would talk about logistics issues for like an hour or so. I don't know if it was every day or maybe it was every other day.
Were you seen as the guy to come in and fix the problem?
That's what I thought. I thought that, you know, I was being hired to come in and try to help from like a high level. And then what happened was they just didn't have enough hands. So we didn't have runners, right? We didn't have drivers. We didn't even have houses for staff at some point. So, you know, I became the de facto housing guy. And that was really because I had a combination of event production history, but also knew how to manage a spreadsheet. And the housing thing was basically matching anyone that needed offsite housing with a bed offsite. And so we went around the island and booked houses and counted the number of beds. And then we would say, okay, this is how many people we have, this is how many beds we have, and we'd start matching them up.
Right, and you get to the Bahamas, they've already made the decision to move from the previous island.
Yeah, by the time I got there, they're living at the Grand Isle in Great Exumas, and they're on the new festival site, which is Roker's Point.
Based on the old festival site,
yeah,
could that have been achieved with a long enough timeline?
No.
No, not at all.
No.
So the vision was impossible.
I think the vision was impossible, and I think, you know, the first gentleman, I forget his name, the pilot that was hired, you know, he had the right idea. If they had just done like a cruise ship and set up some production on that island, it could have been done. But you really couldn't have had anyone camp there. It would have been a miserable experience.
I mean, a cruise ship is quite easy, really.
Yeah, but they refused. I know that was in... So before I got there and before the production team that was there when I arrived got there, there were 2 production teams that had been fired. One was called DPS, which is in the deck that's now circulated, this infamous Fyre deck, which talks about 40,000 attendees, which is a joke because it was max 2,000. But DPS is like festival in a box. I mean, these are the best of the best producers. And apparently what happened was they quoted somewhere around a $50 million budget and said they could get it done in time, but that's what they needed, and they needed Billy to trust them to get it done. Didn't have that budget, fired them. And then they brought in another company, I think it's called CIE.
How long were DPS given?
I don't know. I wasn't there. I think it might have been like a month where right. they were negotiating terms.
But they could have done it.
They said they could have done it. Who knows exactly how they would have pulled it off, but for $50 million.
Well, it goes back to your point. You can buy anything with the right price.
Yeah, because then you can pay for staff. You can ship everything in that you need to get done, right? You could probably double the workforce, which means you could double the speed of the build.
Okay, so you've got to the island.
Mm-hmm.
What is the status of the project? So you look at it and you're going...
Nothing's built. Nothing.
None of the tents are there? None of the beds?
None of the tents. I don't even think the tents had arrived. None of the beds, none of the houses that we needed had been booked. Maybe like 11 suites at the Grand Isle Resort for the festival. You know, production staff there kind of working through logistics. But the thing is, it's not that crazy that there wasn't anything built 1 month before. Because really, you know, you want everything up and running 1 week before the festival for something like this. And so it wasn't that much of a red flag to me.
What were the red flags?
I think the red flags were payments not being made on time, changes to the actual plan and the layout of the festival 4 weeks before. You know, like, I think we realized the first day that I arrived, they realized that there wasn't enough room on Roker's Point for tents for the paid guests. So I think we needed enough beds for 2,100 people, and there were enough for 1,800. And so Billy went through this whole logistics thing and decided we're going to add a whole nother set of tents on the second site, which was called Coco Plum Beach. And we're going to make this like, you know, it's going to be like a VIP area where Coco Plum is like the beach that everybody wants to go to. We're going to make this like, there's this day club in Miami. I forget the name of it. It starts with an N or something. We're going to make it like that. So people are going to sleep. They're going to wake up and they're going to have their bottle service, and we're going to upcharge them for it. So that's our brilliant solution. But then, of course, you know, he makes the decision. All right, go for it. And of course, it's like, okay, but you need an entirely new security staff, right? You need more transportation, you need more laborers to build that site. So, you know, the second and third order consequences of this type of decision were not being thought through specifically, you know, 3 to 4 weeks out from the event. And then it was up to the production staff to try to figure it out. And if we came back with, this is really just not logistically possible, the response was always, we need solutions, not problems. Which is something that, you know, I hope we can talk about other things besides just the logistics of the festival. But I think this solutions, not problems comment is something that we see a lot of, not just in events, but in startup culture in general. And of course, with a festival, you know, the consequences of that are so dramatic and so in your face, because when things fall apart, you can see it so clearly. With startups, that kind of yes culture, that you know, that entrepreneurship porn a little bit, like sleep on the floor of your office, like get it done. You don't see it as much, what the negative consequences are.
Well, it's like you say, you can push timelines in tech.
Yeah.
You know, when the dev tells you 2 weeks, and if it's 3 weeks, it's fine. Or if you have a bug, you fix the bug.
Yeah.
Or if a customer has a bad experience, and you know, you can compensate them, or you can use customer service. With a festival, you have a fixed date, and your entire reputation is based on that single date. So you don't have that flexibility, and we should discuss that. Okay, so you're at the site, you've got an idea of what's going on. How quickly do you realize this isn't going to happen? On the first day, or is it a few days?
I mean, I wish I could say that I was so, you know, prescient to know that this wasn't going to happen from the beginning and I was the smartest guy in the room and I got it. You know, as I said, like, festivals are a mess typically, right? What there's a couple of examples, right? Tomorrow World. Tomorrow World is a festival that was produced by SFX, which was at the time it launched a $1 billion company. It's produced by the same people as Tomorrowland, which is one of the largest festivals in Belgium, in Europe, massive festival. And they tried to replicate it in Atlanta. This is a 120,000 person festival. And it rained like crazy during their second year. And what happened was they had thousands of attendees stranded on site because the buses couldn't move through the dirt roads, right? So that festival got canceled. You had Pemberton in Canada, 40,000 attendee festival, canceled. Attendees not paid back because of logistics challenges. People don't even realize, but the first year of Coachella was a disaster. They lost a ton of money and it almost went under, right? So festivals are always a mess, and it's kind of the job of the production staff to just roll with the punches. And so that's why I think a lot of us were kind of like, this isn't going to happen, or maybe it is. And didn't really walk, if that makes sense.
Yeah. And I guess there is the, will it happen? Won't it happen? But also the, it's not going to happen to
the degree.
Yeah. Or it's not going to be what was sold.
Yeah.
And that must've been pretty clear early on.
That was very clear. That was clear.
I mean, once the tents come on site, right?
Well, yeah. But the thing is, you know, you have siloed work. So my job is to find houses for people off site. You know, you had one person's job was managing the entire festival site. You had another person's job who was marketing and communications. So there's this company called Tableist, which I don't think is mentioned in Netflix, maybe not mentioned in Hulu. This was a company that was, you know, a VIP booking service for clubs in New York, LA, whatever. You know, they were doing really well. Startup, growing, out of business because of Fyre. They did all of the bookings for anything related to this festival, and weren't really a ticketing company, right? So they didn't have a proper ticketing company for communications. And what happened was nobody was communicating these changes to guests. And I wrote, so after Fyre, like 2 months after, I wrote something, a little bit of reflections on the festival. And I think that, you know, it was a mess, of course, but I think that had they been communicating to guests the changes throughout, you know, hey, this is what your package is going to look like. And if guests were able to say, hey, you know, that's not what I paid for, I want my money back, then I think it would have been fine. So in the end, right, these tents look terrible, but the inside was actually really nice. It was carpeted. You know, you had two full-size beds. Of course, IKEA furniture, but it was kind of like a glamping experience. If they had been marketed glamping, then it would have been interesting. It would have been, you know, nice. But none of these changes are kind of marketed. And so as the producers, we're heads down trying to get things done, and we're being told that these communications are happening, and they're not. And so you kind of try to, like, just do your job.
Did you get any one-to-ones with Billy at all?
Yes.
Okay.
I got a few one-to-ones with him.
So tell me about your first one-to-one. How long into being on the island was that? Do you remember what you talked about?
I don't remember my first one-to-one with Billy.
Do you remember your first impressions of him?
Yeah, my first impressions of Billy were, you know, one, he has money. So he's going to be able to, you know, to pay his way through this. Two, he, you know, at the time, this doesn't take no for an answer kind of mentality, I think, was something that impressed me. I was like, oh, like, you know, whenever somebody presents a problem, he doesn't freak out. He's pretty level-headed. He was very, like, always smiling, always seemed calm until the very end. So I thought that was kind of impressive, right? In the face of all these challenges, he was keeping his head, and he had people around him that were really impressive as well. Like some of his investors, you know, these are people, seasoned entrepreneurs, people with, you know, a lot of financial backing. And so I think my first impression was, honestly, I was a little bit impressed. But then you start to kind of pull back the facade, and you realize there's not a lot of depth. So decisions are being made without really any thought going into them. And as time continued to progress, I realized that all he cared about was his image and was the image of the festival. So a really simple solution to the housing crisis that we had offsite, because we didn't have we had zero beds booked by the time I got there. We needed, I was told 400 beds, and then eventually it was 1,200 beds. And the island has a population of 3,000 to 5,000 people, depending on what source you look at. And so, you know, the simple solution is we have a second weekend, and we have all the beds on the entire island available to us that weekend if we need them, because the first weekend was this national regatta event. Simple solution, cancel all of the influencers from weekend one. Anyone that doesn't absolutely need a bed, that didn't pay for a bed, should just be moved to weekend two. And it became so clear to me that all he and his team cared about were the influencers. And it wasn't even because of the marketing angle, which I think they understood and noticed, but I think it was because they wanted to hang out with models. Honestly, right. It was like, we want to ride jet skis with models. So in some ways, I think he produced the festival for his own personal kind of, like, it was like a play thing for him. Right. You know?
Well, you get that picture from the early footage when they recorded the advert. Mm-hmm. You know, you see the early experience, and it's kind of like almost too wrapped up in the enjoyment of and the success before they've delivered.
Yeah.
Which kind of feels sometimes a little bit like the crypto markets at times. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, the
you want to talk about ICOs. I mean, raising tens of millions of dollars before you have even a team in place, right? And you just have an idea. I mean, that's pretty similar.
So did Billy have any obvious weaknesses when you first met him as well? Beyond the, you know, it was a play thing.
Yeah, I mean, that was definitely one of his inexperience. You know, like, again, there's a certain level of arrogance, I think, that comes with having been a tech founder, whatever Magnesis was, and having some level of success. And then you think, I can do anything, and events are easy. And I really think that arrogance is something that a lot of people bring with them when they go into an industry that might seem simple, like opening a restaurant, right? Which in the end is extremely challenging. And so I think arrogance was definitely something that I saw. And you know, it's one thing to try to find solutions to problems. It's another thing to not take advice of the people that you hired around you because they have the experience that you don't. And it was clear that he wasn't taking people's advice. And so I think that definitely ties to some level of arrogance.
All right. So I was going to say the weeks are going by, but as the weeks go by, the festival hits, right? So the days are going by.
Days are going by.
What are the big red flags where you're like, okay, we're in big trouble now?
Yeah, I think... Well, for me, the first big red flag was about 2 weeks out from the festival. I finally had convinced, so I'm in it for 2 weeks. I'm continually matching beds. Maybe it was even a week and a half out from the festival. I make my first call to one of the influencers on our influencer list. And so the guys had tiered influencers into three categories. And finally, I had convinced them to cancel some of the influencers who had been promised free accommodations for posting that little orange square on their Instagram accounts. Mm-hmm. And I get on my first call, and I'm trying to communicate to this person, we have a second weekend, you know, you can move there. And they're like, well, our flights are booked, you know, to Miami from Los Angeles, and we were promised a villa by the beach. Me and two guests. And so that's when I realized, like, we had about 200 of these people who were all promised a three-person villa on the beach, and those just didn't exist. And not to mention, I was the first voice that these people had heard since they posted the orange box on Instagram. So they had zero communication about anything. And so that's when I started kind of, you know, freaking out a little bit. And that was kind of the first major red flag. Obviously, there were a bunch of little red flags along the way. Another one was when, you know, I had been brought into this specific role because when I visited the island the first time to negotiate my deal, I sat down with one of the investors, Carola, who was working on this housing thing, and I started just working in a spreadsheet with her. So she and I started working really closely together. And I would update her pretty regularly, almost daily, about the housing situation. Because, you know, these were investors, these were press, these were people that they really wanted to make sure were taken care of. And every day I would send an email to Corolla, to Billy, to all of the senior management with the numbers. And I got a call from Grant basically telling me that they were trying to get more money from Corolla, that my emails were alarming her, and that I need to cut off all communication with her. And so I said, absolutely not. You know, this is not how I operate. I want to operate with some level of honesty and openness. And I spoke to Skywalker, who was interviewed in the Hulu documentary and who's awesome, you know, seasoned event producer. And I was like, look, like, I don't exactly know how to navigate this situation. And he was like, don't worry about it. Every email you send, I'll share with Corolla. It's fine. We'll just deal with it that way. And so so that's red flag kind of number two, like major red flag. Major red flag number three is we lost our caterer 1 week until the festival. And so...
Lack of payment.
Yeah. They tried to renegotiate. We had Star Catering, which is like fancy culinary masterpieces. You know, he owns like six of the best restaurants in Philadelphia, New York. I think Le Bernardin is one of them. And so we get the word that we lose our caterer because we had been in negotiations with them. They kept cutting back costs, whatever. Star pulls out and everyone's like, okay, the festival's done. We have no food, right? No festival. So there's this email that leaked to Mike.com right after the festival, which was a producer basically on a Port-a-John's chain. And I know her well. She's great. And she meant well, but the food doesn't come. And so basically she sends an email in response like, it doesn't matter how many Port-a-John's we have because people won't be eating, so they won't be shitting. And of course, like, you know, like we talk about media and taking things out of context. And of course, you know, 2 months after when the festival did happen and it was a mess, this looks like the most arrogant, disgusting email ever sent. But the reason it was sent is because, you know, we didn't have food. So we thought that the festival would be canceled.
Okay, so you're a week out. You've got no catering. You haven't got enough villas.
Yeah.
I mean, it must
I'm getting PTSD.
Yeah, right now, so like you must get to the point you go, okay.
Yeah, this is done.
This is done. There must be conversations where people are saying, we have to cancel.
Yes.
And is Billy the only person who can make that decision?
So Billy is the go, no go. You know, short of every single person walking out, which, you know, when I reflect on it and, you know, I say this in the documentary as well, it's like, if we hadn't kept working, maybe this never would have happened. Right. Because he needed people working for him.
So in some ways you're feeling complicit?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I mean, that's a kind of brave thing to admit.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I think that it was like we were pulling rabbits out of hats, you know, like we didn't have enough beds. So in the end, I ended up sourcing that cruise ship that we spoke about. And it was a small one because it was on very short notice, 10 days. We got a cruise ship to come and house 225 people, right? Had that not happened, you know, we definitely wouldn't have had enough beds for staff.
At what cost?
Oh man, the cost, I think it was $500,000 in the end.
Okay.
And we put down $250,000. And the cruise ship is how I discovered that Billy was sending fake wires. And we could talk about that, but basically the day after everyone arrived, we had about 1,100 people on the island. We were working with the charter company to evacuate them. Billy was nowhere to be found. At least for me, I think Skywalker was in touch with him. There were maybe like five event producers still there trying to get people off, having not been paid. And the cruise operator calls and says, hey, we have 225 people on this boat. We were supposed to be moored for 2 weeks. We have enough fuel to get us to Miami. I'm in touch with the Coast Guard there. I can bring people home. And I'm like, this is a great option. Let's do that. And so I, you know, finally get a hold of Billy. And he's like, sure thing, like, we'll get it done. I'm like, the guy says he needs payment in his bank account by 5 p.m. Billy's like, well, we'll send a wire. You know, isn't that good enough? So I call the guy and I'm like, hey, the cruise owner. And I'm like, hey, you know, Billy says we're going to go through with this. We're going to send you a wire confirmation. He says, absolutely not. He's like, I need the money in my bank account by 5 p.m. today. And I was like, why? Like, wire confirmation is as good as, you know, whatever. And he's like, the last time I got a wire conf from Billy, it didn't come for 5 days after. And it was a different confirmation number than the one he had sent to me.
Next up, I talked to Mark more about what happened at the Fyre Festival, but before that, I got a message from my show sponsors. So first up, we're going to talk about BlockFi and the new announcement that they have launched crypto interest accounts. Have you checked them out yet? I did catch up with Zach in New York to ask him a few things about it, so let's hear what he has to say. So one thing that comes to mind is that there appears to be no reason for me now to hold my Bitcoin in a private wallet. I can hold it with you guys and earn interest, but at the same time, then people will say, not your keys, not your Bitcoin. What do you think about that?
I think that one of the valuable aspects of cryptocurrency and Bitcoin is that you have the option to completely self-custody and hold your private keys and own that responsibility. For some users, I think that that's not an ideal situation for them. Things like earning interest on it, things like not having that full responsibility, and things that look and feel like the same services that they're used to in traditional financial asset classes is also valuable. And so it might not be for everyone. There are components of the system, for example, that when you want to withdraw, you have to wait for BlockFi to process the withdrawal. Now that happens quickly, but that's very different than holding your own private keys and being able to send them at the speed of the Bitcoin network. In exchange for that, what you get is an interest rate on your Bitcoin, paid in Bitcoin. You have a support desk that you can contact anytime who can help you with whatever you need. And in the future, we'll be adding incremental features, like, for example, the ability to designate a beneficiary. If, God forbid, something were to happen to one of our clients and we needed to know what to do with their Bitcoin that was in their interest account, we would have a name and contact information for an individual that should be passed on to. And we'll continue to build features and functionality that make it friendly for those clients who don't want to hold on to their private keys or are attracted enough to the value proposition that we offer to give up holding on to their private keys.
And how do people find out more?
Visit BlockFi.com, contact us at support@BlockFi.com. We have a chat box on the website that's super easy to use. We're on Twitter @TheRealBlockFi, and don't hesitate to reach out.
Also, let's talk about Cash App again. Just got to say a massive thanks to the team for supporting the work and becoming a sponsor and helping me get out the Mt. Gox shows. They helped me get to Japan, so thank you so much for that. So what is a Cash App? Have you got it yet? I've talked about them for a few weeks now. I've got it myself. Have you tried it out? Have you downloaded it? Have you sent some money? Have you received some money? I'd love to hear from you if you have. I'd love to hear your feedback. I love it. I think it's such an amazing app. So why should you care? Cash App is the first traditional peer-to-peer payments app to support Bitcoin. It comes with most of the features of a traditional bank. You've got the ability to direct deposit your paycheck into the app. You get a physical, customizable debit card linked to spend from, and you can earn 10% cash back at places like Whole Foods with your cash boots. And they can be used in tandem with your Bitcoin balance. There's no app out there like it, so you should definitely go and check it out. The experience of buying and selling Bitcoin is really easy. It literally only takes two clicks, and you receive your Bitcoin immediately. And they are committed to supporting Bitcoin. You can see that with everything Jack's been doing, so that's super cool. So definitely go check them out. It's available on the Apple and Play stores. You can find it by searching for Cash App, which is C-A-S-H-A-P-P. And just a note, Bitcoin buying and selling is only available in the US right now. Okay, so I don't understand wires and wire confirmations. So can you explain how that works and how you do it fraudulently?
For sure. So I think what was happening was when you are about to send the wire, for some bank accounts, it gives you like a little strip at the bottom and it says like transaction details, transaction number, amount sent, to whom, et cetera. And then it has at the end again the transaction number. And then it's like click send to confirm. I think what Billy was doing is he was taking a screenshot of that page.
But not
and then sending it out and not clicking it. Exactly.
Oh,
and
wow.
So we were sending these thin strips with all that information that looked like it was confirmed, but it would never be sent.
Okay. See, like I say, you're still a week out. It's clear it's screwed, but Billy's not taking no for an answer.
Not taking no for an answer. And you know, in all honesty, there is this still kind of element amongst the crew. We've been working on this, you know, day in and day out. You know, we've all been in events before. Things are messy, but you know, if this has to happen, this has to happen. We're going to make it work no matter what.
Even 2 days out, even a day out.
Yeah, I mean the head production manager, in two meetings prior to the event, said we should cancel.
Okay.
The day before, that there were two all hands meetings where the production manager, the lead, who's in neither documentary.
Good person.
Yeah. Really good person. Seasoned event producer. You know, good head on her shoulders. I think overwhelmed as we all were, lacking sleep, but it was like, we need to cancel this thing. No, it has to happen. And the response is kind of ridiculous. It was like, money solves all problems.
But the money wasn't there.
The money wasn't there. But I think what in Billy's mind, right, they were, I believe, $19 million in the hole on this festival. So like, real dollars were spent, real building happened, you know.
How much was raised in total?
I'm not sure.
Okay.
But a lot of revenue was used to pay for this. And so there's this whole part of the documentary where, you know, they started encouraging people to load up their RFID bands.
Yep.
And that was, I think, their way of trying to get new working capital to fund expenses.
But did they even have an RFID supplier?
They did, yeah.
Oh, they did. So they had that. Okay. So, I mean, how stressful? Can you even explain how stressful it is?
Well, my shoulders are like up in my ears right now talking about it.
So it's stressful now even thinking about it?
Yeah. 2 years later. I mean, it was really stressful. Like, we were a skeleton crew trying to pull off the impossible with basically like no sleep. You know, I was doing housing and I slept on a different couch or a different bed, pretty much every night. You know, because we had more people coming in throughout the month and we needed people to have beds. And so as the staff grew, we were trying to get houses for them and it was just a disaster.
And everyone was stressed?
Everyone was stressed.
People breaking down?
Chain smoking cigarettes, breakdowns pretty much every day. You know, you're in this beautiful place in the Bahamas and you're sitting in front of a computer all day inside of a house or running around on phone calls. You know, there were fights, there were, you know, crying, breakdowns. It was a mess, right? It was a mess.
And then it starts to rain.
Yeah, I mean,
what? Oh, come on. Like, I watched that and I just, do you know what? I just watched that moment and I almost felt with you guys in that. That was the moment where I wasn't just watching it. I suddenly became immersed and had that combination of massive sympathy and couldn't stop laughing.
Yeah. Like,
me neither. What, the only rain in what, months?
Yeah, it hadn't rained really the whole time I was there. And I hadn't considered it. And the thing is, when you're so underwater on just getting the plan A, the plan B for rain is non-existent. And so, you know, like, as bad of a plan as it was, the idea was we had waves of guests coming in each day. And the people building the site 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, had decided we had enough tents for the first wave. And so it'll be a mess, but they'll come to the site, they'll go to the main production house, we'll assign them a tent, they'll go to their tent, and we'll have enough beds. That's what was thought. And we'll keep the production staff building all day on Thursday, and we'll finish the last 100 tents. I think in the end, there was a cargo ship that never came because customs wasn't paid. And that had all of the air mattresses for all of the houses that I was accounting for. So basically, I was short 200 beds. It had all of our walkie-talkies. So there was no communication except via cell phone, which was a mess. Cell service was terrible. Phones were dying across the island. And it had, I think, the remaining tents as well. And so that never could have been pulled off anyways. But then it rains and the tents that we had were all flooded because a lot of them were left opened. People didn't think to close them.
Did that have a, how much of a negative impact did the rain have, or was it fucked anyway? I mean, was whole, or did that compound things, actually make it much worse? And even like,
it's really hard to say whether or not it would have been completely fucked without it, because, and this is like some, I hate saying this because it's some vindication of the things that Billy did, but, you know, there were guests that were like, this is fine. We want to stay. We paid for a trip to the Bahamas. They didn't want to leave on the flights that we got for them on that Friday.
Then we just make the best of it.
They were like, yeah, we're in the Bahamas. There's beautiful beaches. Thursday, we had a group of DJs, kind of the undercard DJs, Zero something. They all played on Thursday.
Hold on. So none of this is told?
Yeah. So the music, I think they tell it in Netflix. Like Luca, who's in the documentary, Unreal Productions, you know, he's another person who I think is honest about, had we basically held firm deadlines for payment and really been forceful, there never would have been a stage, so there never would have been a festival. But they built that, they've shipped and built two stages.
Well, that's the one bit in the documentary where it looks like everything is as it should be. The
exactly.
stage and the setup.
Exactly. Unreal Productions did an incredible job on the stage.
So I saw that and I thought, that looks right.
Yep.
So I'm guessing, even with crappy beds, even with crappy food, yep. as long as you can supply some alcohol
yep.
and you could get people to the stage, they can have
exactly.
some fun, right?
And that I think was, as you said, like, go, no-go decision a couple of days before. Do you guys think this is going to be a disaster? That was the mindset. It was like, it's not going to be what people expected it to be, but, you know, we'll be able to get them into their beds and logistics are going to be a mess, but then they'll start having fun. And all the liquor was there, all the bar, we had 45 hospitality staff ready to go. You know, what we were lacking was really on the pyramid of festival production, we were lacking the foundation, which was housing, transportation, and the core staff to get it done.
Okay.
You know, the builders, the runners, the drivers, everything like that. And so there was this kind of hope that we could get it done, and then it starts raining, and now the problem is you can't bring people to the site because their tents aren't ready, because the tents are soaked. And
you held them at the bar, right?
And we basically had no place to hold them. And it was now 5 a.m. when the first plane was supposed to arrive at 7 a.m. and it ended up arriving at 6:20.
Just a side point while I remember. One of the things that stood out to me when I was looking at the site, it looked dangerous because it seemed to have that kind of steep edge down to almost like a river inside before the sea. Do you know the bit I'm talking about?
Yeah, so Roker's Point had these cliffs.
Yeah, how high are they?
Probably like 10 to 20 feet high.
So I just had this really bad feeling that they weren't fenced off.
Mm.
You would have drunk people, and it'd be quite dark, and they could easily fall off these edges. Was
yeah,
that
for
a concern?
Sure. I'm sure it was a concern, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that there was definitely a plan for fencing. I don't remember if there was fencing put in around these edges, but safety was the paramount concern. I mean, we had another thing, right, when you're building on an island.
Like if somebody dies.
Yeah. This is a totally different story.
Yeah.
I mean, we, in the end, so I, this is another kind of, I don't know, again, to your point about like sounding, having people like troll you or whatever. The day that we evacuated the 1,100 people was like one of the proudest days of my life.
Well, listen, let's come to that.
Yeah.
But also, physically, I can see your face has changed in the last kind of 5 minutes. It's almost like I'm bringing the stress back.
Yeah.
Big deal, right? Okay, so, and I'm going to add to that stress, sorry, probably with this question, but
no worries.
You wake up on the day of the festival.
Yeah.
3 a.m., 4 a.m., do you remember?
No, didn't sleep.
Oh, you didn't sleep.
Jorge, who was doing transportation to all the houses, and I were together pretty much side by side for the last like 10 days. And
okay.
He slept 20 minutes and I woke him up.
Okay, so what time do you consider that day has started?
Yeah, so we were at this house, which was for an investor, and we didn't have beds. And so we went there because they had these like lounge chairs, movie theater things. So we slept on the leather chairs sat on them. A couple of people slept. And I think it's like 6. Again, another element of the rain is we had this cruise ship that I sourced for staff the night before because I wanted them in comfortable beds. And then they were going to turn it. It's like a floating hotel the next day for influencers. And the cruise ship turned out, we were so close, it was 20 feet too large for the dock. And so it had to be moored offsite. We worked with the Coast Guard to try to get it done. In the end, they said no. So it's moored offsite. So there's this whole tender operation. And the rain happens and the seas are rough. And we had a 40-person hospitality crew meant to welcome the guests that were stuck on the cruise ship. And so Jorge and I drive to the airport. We get the call. We decided we had a rain plan. We articulated it to a couple of the producers. Change of plans immediately right after that. But me and Jorge are the only two people at the airport to welcome the first flights. because we're laughing. We're like, it's raining. At least the flights will be delayed. Nothing's ever on time in the Bahamas. And the flight comes an hour early. So we're there. The guests come off the buses. And another ridiculous decision that was made was that the bags were supposed to meet the people on site. But the reason that was made was because there was supposed to be a crew in Miami tagging bags with tent numbers. But the tents weren't ready, so there were no tent numbers. And so no bags get tagged because there's no one there. There's no communication with the hospitality staff in Miami. And all the bags are basically taken right off the plane, thrown into a truck, driven to the site with no tags. And the driver is just this local guy who's like, has no idea what he's supposed to be doing. And just chucks them into an empty cargo bin, like an empty shipping container. And Jorge and I are there greeting the guests. We're the only two people. And they're all like, where are our bags? We just came off. Some of them just came off of like 10 hours of travel from Europe, from Los Angeles. And they're in their plain clothes and they want to go to the beach. And they're like, we need to change. Where are our bags? And Jorge and I are like on site. Like, we don't know because we're not involved in this plan. We're not supposed to be greeting the guests. It's just because we're the only people left. The reason we were at the airport is because there's no addresses on this island. And there's one set of keys for every house that we booked.
And the keys were lost.
I had the keys.
Oh, you had the keys?
Yeah.
I thought the keys went missing.
No, they didn't go missing.
Ah.
That was reported. That was reported by Billy in the Hulu doc, apparently, correct?
Yes, in the Hulu doc, that the box of keys went missing.
The box of keys didn't go missing. We were greeting all of the guests with the keys, giving them the one set of keys for the houses, and then Jorge would tell the taxi driver where to drive because he was the head of transportation. And I was the only one that knew. He and I were the only two people that knew where the addresses were for the houses. And so, you know, this bag thing is a huge issue because now the guests aren't going to the site anymore. And originally we wanted to send them to the rec center, hold them there, say, you know, because of the rain, we're going to hold you here for a little bit, serve them breakfast, figure it out. But instead, somebody makes the executive decision to send them to the Grand Isle Resort. Now, this is like a fully functioning hotel, right? Like one of those all expense paid type places. And a bus, a yellow school bus of 120, you know, millennials shows up unannounced and they just start raging. And so the Grand Isle kicks them out and then everybody gets sent to Marianne's bar. And Marianne is there. Finally, the hospitality staff is out and there's a bar staff there and Jorge and I are still at the airport. Now my phone dies. And this bag thing is clearly a real problem, one of many, and we don't have communication because we don't have walkie-talkies. And so I'm like, we need to get this sorted. I drive to Billy's house to meet with him, and he's not there. And the whole point is we need someone with the authority to tell the airport to let people take their bags with them. And more flights are coming in. And so then finally, Billy's not there. I charge my phone, and this might be why maybe someone said the keys were missing. So then I get a call. I also get a call from Tablelist, and I had kind of logistically matched all of the VIP guests and all of the influencers with a house. And I start getting calls from Tablelist of new guests that had been booked for VIP housing and paid extra within the last 5 days. So there I am trying to cancel as many people as I possibly could. And the Fyre team are out booking more VIP guests who were promised houses for cash. And so I'm freaking out. I'm like, I don't know. I get a call from Tablelist. I'm like, I don't know what to tell you. Like, I had everything set up. We had enough beds, but these people were not on the list and they can't get a house. We need to put them on site. So it's clear we don't have enough beds, even more abundantly clear. And I go to the Blue Production House on site to, again, get someone to make this decision to let the bags out. And it's like mayhem. You know, line around the block. Everybody inside of the house is... Everyone inside of the house is freaking out. Literally, I'm now getting pulled physically by my shirt by all of the core Fyre staffs and admins. Each of them had their own like secretary for some reason. And they're like, what about this group came and that sponsor's here and they need this and they need that. And they're like, Mark. And I'm like, throw my hands up in the air, step outside. I'm like, I don't know what to do. And I decide, okay, I'm going to get in one of these cars and just drive. And so I get in a car and I drive to where I had been staying and I jump in the pool fully clothed and basically strip down from my clothes, sit under a tree and just like fall asleep.
Did you have a cigarette?
Slept for like 3 days.
Did you have a cigarette?
potentially.
Yeah. I mean, I guess you get to that point where you're, it's almost like it's overwhelming, right? You're like, yeah. I don't know what to do. I've probably had a couple of moments like that in my life where I'm just like, everything is too much.
Yeah.
I can't fix this.
There's nothing to do. And at that point, again, I call the head of production and Corolla, and I'm like, we've talked about this many times. If the decision hasn't already been made, there should be no more flights coming into this island.
Is Corolla a victim of this?
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll come to that because it's funny. I usually try and do an hour interview. We're an hour and 3 minutes, and I'm writing down more questions than we're getting through because it's.
And we haven't even talked about crypto yet.
We haven't, and we'll cover it at the end. But like, okay, so
he told me we were going to talk about crypto.
Well, I'm just kidding. I mean, you started out with Bitcoin. You know, you're in. You're good. All right. So listen, you're going to sit under a tree. What kind of time of day is that?
I think at this point it's not dark yet. It's like, it's probably like 2.
And this is the Thursday?
This is the Thursday.
So we've already had the bit where Billy's gone and stood on the table as well.
So no, that hasn't happened yet.
Oh, is that?
That happens a few hours later.
Okay. So you fall asleep under a tree.
I wake up like 20 minutes later.
Yeah. Okay. You've had your power nap.
Now I just start again. My phone's been blowing up because there are new guests coming that need their keys to their houses.
Okay, so let's go. What happens next?
So I'm driving around the island to meet up with as many people as I can to get them into their house.
And how are people being with you? Like, are you explaining like this is a shit show, I'm sorry, or are you just pushing people into their thing?
Remember that my role was for people that were getting housing offsite. And most of them were investors, influencers, press, staff.
But were they all aware that?
So I'd been the only point of contact for some of these people for the previous week. And I had told most of them not to come.
Okay.
So I had been like, don't come or come the second weekend. You're not going to get what you were promised. You were promised a villa by the beach. I'm telling you right now, you're going to be in like quote unquote model style housing. So like air mattresses, bunk beds in a shared house with people that you don't know.
Okay.
And so most of those people that I had told this to are treating me with some level of like gratitude and respect. Like I had no idea that it was this bad type of thing, but thank you. And you know, specifically like there was a, again, right? Like they had hired a 40 person marketing team to come film. And I had been on calls with this team for a whole week being like, don't come. Going back to Grant saying, we need to cut this crew. We don't need content. When I did a festival, we had 3 people filming to get the recap video. That's all you need. You don't need this crew. And if you want to bring them the second weekend. Again, like we had another weekend. No, no, no. I'm arguing with these people. You know, these are contractors, right? They can't share beds. They can't share rooms. That's a huge liability for them. And they're telling me, we need our own rooms for each guest. And I'm telling them, these don't exist. And so they get down and they had thought, I'm the bad guy, right? A lot of influencers too thought I was the bad guy because they thought I was trying to rob them of their experience. And then they get down and they see this and they're like, wow, like, I'm sorry. Now, that was the majority. There was a couple of situations where I got in. Basically, like I don't think I've ever lost my cool the way that I lost it on the Casamigos team, for example.
Okay, talk me through that.
It's now like 1 a.m. The Casamigos team comes with a crew that's twice the size of what had been promised, what I had been told. They need a house. I'm trying to figure out what house to put them in. I kind of connect with them multiple times. I drive to them. They're at some bar, and I give 2 of them the keys to this house. They get to the house. It's not to their liking. They're calling me nonstop. My phone's dying. I'm over my head trying to figure it out. Finally, it's nighttime and I get to the production house and they're there. And the lead starts going off at me, basically telling me I'm going to get fired, telling me, you know, do you know who I am? And I'm like, I just snapped. I was like, fired. I haven't been paid. I'm running around trying to make sure that you have a bed to sleep in. And this is the way that you're treating me, you know? And later on, like I think he and I had a chat the next day and it was fine. But
well, that's good.
That was one example. There was another example, which I feel pretty terrible about, but an athlete came with his daughter. He had done the influencer marketing and I think his daughter was sick and his agent, you know, and I had been on a call and we canceled most of the people that they had booked. But there was this one guy that they really needed to come because he had promised this beautiful experience to his daughter who was sick. And I thought that I had enough beds for him at the Grand Isle. And apparently he got to the Grand Isle and there was no bed for him. And so she called me freaking out and she and I got into it. This was probably about like 2 a.m. at that time. And I, you know, of course, feel terrible because that was something that slipped through the cracks. But yeah, and then finally it was like 2 a.m. to 3 a.m. Every single person that needed a bed had one, at least from my perspective. You know, the job was done and everybody was on site in their tents. The line had finally cleared and, you know, we had a meeting at the production house. We're all going to have an all hands at 7 a.m. the next day.
So at that point, you're thinking, okay, we're maybe scraping through this?
No, I mean, it was all the flights had been canceled. Mm-hmm. It was like, how are we going to treat the people that arrived? The Twitter storm had already taken off. All of the main acts had canceled, mostly because they hadn't been paid their remaining deposits. So there was going to be no music. And it was just like, how do we deal with the people that are still here?
But you said there was some music on the Thursday.
Yeah.
So what kind of happened? Was there like some camaraderie? Were people almost experiencing some element of a festival?
I think there, I mean, again, like I was running around doing my thing. I think one, the influencers that had their houses off site had an incredible weekend. I've spoken to some of them. They basically just had like a free weekend in the Bahamas where they got to just do whatever they wanted and just never really went to the site.
Because there's other facilities on the island. Which is
the irony of the whole thing. Yeah, I mean, it's a beautiful place, right? You have some of the nicest beaches in the world. A lot of guests, there was like a first wave of people that just wanted to get out of there. And that was the whole airport fiasco, which I didn't really know much about, but, you know, they wanted to get out. The first flight out was delayed and then they got locked in or something into the airport. And that was a disaster. But then after that first kind of wave, there was probably about like 500 people and all they wanted to do was stay and have a good time. And all the liquor was free. You know, the food was free. It was just kind of like sustaining them. And I think a lot of people really had fun, which is crazy.
Well, sometimes when something goes completely shit, the whole event changes, but it becomes fun in a different way because you have to, I don't know, you're part of a story, right?
Yeah, they adapted and they thought they were part of something special.
Okay, we probably missed so much. But talk to me about the evacuation, the decision. You said it was your proudest moment.
Yeah.
So what brings the decision for cancellation and talk me through the evacuation?
Well, so that afternoon when I called the head of production and I called Corolla and basically was like, if it hasn't happened already, this is unsustainable. We need to stop the flights coming in. They were like, decision's been made. It's done.
So was that decision made
Thursday?
Outside of Billy?
It was made outside of Billy, yeah.
Right, okay.
Maybe Billy was looped in and finally realized, like, you know, at this point, Billy was finally like, you could see him. He was frazzled. For the first time.
And was he getting a lot of aggressive kind of aggression towards him?
Yeah, for sure.
So he went through a shit day.
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, you have all this unpaid workers, unpaid customs. People were really pissed. Yeah. And so Andy says Andy hid in the trunk somewhere. I don't know that he needed to do that, but or how dangerous it really was. But, you know, he left.
So Andy was an interesting one because he comes across as responsible, organized, but at the same time, it felt like he was the guy who should have had the clout and the ability to convince Billy to cancel.
Yeah, and I think he's self-reflective in the documentary as well, where he's like, you know, like we would go to Andy and Andy would say, I've worked with Billy before, you know, like he always gets it done. He always finds a way. He always raises the money at the last second. Like this is the way he operates. And so he was a bridge in a lot of ways.
All right. Anyway, back to the cancellation, the evacuation. Yeah. What happens?
Yeah, so anyway, so everyone's canceled. There's about like 800 attendees on site. We have a 7 a.m. all hands. None of the fire staff are anywhere to be found, meaning like the core team. They're off somewhere. We think, you know, Billy's on a yacht or they're at the Grand Isle hiding or they left the island. And it's like me and like five or six other producers And we're like, okay, you know, what are we going to do? And the decision is made, and Skywalker basically takes like de facto control. And it's like, decision's been made. I'm in touch with the charter company. They're working with us. We're going to get flights today moved up because all the flights were scheduled for Sunday, Monday, and we're going to get people off of this island. And so we work literally all day. We have, you know, two or three people taking names. Everybody's getting on flights. We have to like validate who came through. Literally, the charter company has a legal obligation to get everyone off the island that they brought onto the island.
Right. Okay. Because I was going to ask who paid for that.
Yeah. Honestly, it's them, because okay. I think it's contractual. If a charter company brings people out of the U.S. to a foreign country, I believe they're responsible for bringing them back.
Okay.
And so, you know, we basically just worked all day. This was the time when you see in the video, like, the workers came. There were about 30 of them. Security hadn't been paid. And they're outside of the house, and there's, like, five of us. And, you know, we're at this point actually concerned that there might be some violence because, you know, people worked really hard, and it's hot. And, you know, you're working 20 hours a day, or however long they were working, not getting paid, you're going to be pissed. And I think, you know, Skywalker stepped outside. I was outside with a few other people, and we're able to really talk to them, because I think they realized that we were in kind of the same position that they were in a lot of ways. You know, we hadn't been paid. We were still working. We felt like we had been taken advantage of. We didn't want this to happen. And so it kind of fizzled, which was nice. There was like a camaraderie there. And then we, you know, again, we got everyone off the island. We had had a group of 18 doctors that were supposed to come, but the license was never paid for them to operate. The only person that got hurt was someone that stepped on a sea urchin, you know, and like, that is a huge accomplishment considering how big of a mess this was. And so I remember watching the last flight take off. I was at the airport with another producer, and she and I basically just like hugged, saw the last flight take off. We were like, you know, we did it. Like, we got them.
When was that?
We got them off. It was probably around like midnight on Friday.
Okay. So one thing that isn't covered that I'd be interested to know is, well, then what? Is there a cleanup operation?
Yeah. So that's a great question. I ended up staying for a week after the festival. There were a few of us that stayed.
Unpaid.
Yeah.
Expenses covered? Are you being fed?
We're being fed. Still being fed, yeah.
Like, who owns the duty to clear up at that point?
So I think that there was definitely one major investor who took a certain level of responsibility. He's a really stand-up guy, you know, successful entrepreneur, and Skywalker was working with him. And they kind of took de facto responsibility of the situation, trying to make amends. I mean, we had, you know, potentially hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of merchandise and worth of liquor in shipping containers on site. And it was really just about getting people paid at that point, getting customs paid so that we can start breaking the site down and shipping it back. And, you know, we went to the site. Probably like four or five of us went to the site every single day, and we're meeting with the customs people, helping the catering company, not Marianne, but there's another catering company that came, helping them get their people off the island. I was cleaning, getting the houses cleaned, collecting all the keys. There were cars left all over the island. We needed to get them returned to the rental car place. So we were kind of figuring out which keys went with which cars and trying to get that sorted.
How big a team involved?
Again, there were probably like five of us at this point.
And camaraderie between you lot?
I mean, again,
was this a bit less stressful? Were you having a drink at the end of the day?
It was less stressful at this time. There were still probably like 15, 20 producers on the island who like needed a break, you know, and they ended up staying in one of the houses off site. And, you know, there was definitely a camaraderie. There was a campiness to it. For the group of us that kept going back to the site, it felt like we had a mission, you know, and it felt really important to try to clean up the mess. And so we got everybody, again, like we got everybody off site. And then we were just working with customs every day. And one of the biggest issues was the production equipment that Luca and his team had built, was not his, right? He had rented it to bring it, and they did a great job and they did their job and they were left unpaid, but the equipment was basically held by customs. And so part of the negotiation was like, how can we help him get his equipment off of the island? And that's where a lot of the focus was.
Okay. So
and it took a month and a half for that to happen.
Okay. But what was the final job where you knew, right, we're done, I'm done, I'm finished here?
I think it was basically just like we got there and there was just no more discussions to be had.
Right. Okay. So
there wasn't really a job. It was kind of like the negotiations had stalled and the government took over the site.
Oh, they took over the site. Okay. So you realized, right, I'm done. I can leave. Okay.
Yeah.
Did you have a final night there? Did you get drunk? I mean, I'm assuming you must have all got wasted.
Yeah, we had a night. We had a night, like 10 producers, like great people. You know, that's what's lost. Like event producers are the salt of the earth, in my opinion. You know, it's just a humility and a love that they have for creating events that make people happy.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not necessarily the most financially rewarding role, especially when you're doing things like logistics, but they, you know, they're great people. And so we had a blast.
Okay. So the event's done. Were you paid anything at any
point? I got 30% of my fee up front.
Okay. 30% up front. The other 70% never came.
Yeah, no.
So, yeah.
And there was a lawsuit, you know, there was a lawsuit, of guests against Billy and the company. There was a lawsuit of producers. The head production manager put together a tally of what everyone was owed, put together a lawsuit and filed. I didn't participate in the lawsuit because, one, I knew there was no money there and I kind of wanted to move on. Ironically, obviously, that hasn't happened.
Yeah.
Here we are 2 years later. But yeah, they just, nobody had gotten paid.
But I think it's a good thing that you've chosen to talk about it, like even on my little podcast, because lots of people have watched the documentary. It's one of those ones that's just created a buzz and everyone's like, have you seen the Fyre documentary? But you've told me so many things I didn't know about today, you know, and you've changed some perceptions I had of certain people or certain decisions in the process. So I think it's good that you do it. And you know, we learn from all situations, right? So
yeah, for sure.
Okay, so you're done. You get on your flight.
Yeah.
You fly back to what, LA?
New York.
You fly back to New York and you must have been like, what?
Yeah, what the fuck happened?
Like, yeah, what was like the next week like?
Again, right, like I left that island feeling capable, which I know is, it's going to sound ridiculous, but we pulled off, you know, small little magical acts throughout the course of that month. And I've never felt more confident in my ability to do good work. And, you know, I was kind of in the process of selling my second business, 90s Fest, which hadn't been as successful as I would have wanted it to have been. And that was a mess. And, you know, I finally had regained some self-confidence after two startups that didn't work out the way that I had hoped. And the first week was like riding that wave of momentum. And then I think the week after it finally hit like a little bit of that, wow, I just went through something really crazy and stressful, and I just got pretty down for about, you know, a month or so.
And what were you doing that month? What happened?
There just wasn't much to do, and I think that's why, because I had been also while I was there trying to get a 90s Fest third year tour going, and that fell through, and so I was kind of in now what phase, and you know, when you have that empty space, you have a lot to think about.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, it was really around that time when the crypto work went from more of a hobby to more of like a, this is so real and I'm just going to dive into this as much as I possibly can.
So it sounds like you just needed a focus, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And how much, like, direct flack did you take? How much, you know, attention was on you that you felt was unfair? Kind of what was going on?
Well, I had stayed out of pretty much everything, right? I was just a plebe in the whole thing. And most of the producers have gotten out and never mentioned again. I didn't really get much shit.
Okay.
And then, yeah.
Because I know I asked you this earlier, but I'm piecing the timeline together. So you're off the island. Have you spoken to Billy in person or on the phone since you've got off the island?
No, I didn't really want to talk to him. I sent him an email.
Right. Corolla?
Corolla, yes. We had a conversation or two. Basically, like, I would work with you again. That's kind of what I articulated to her, and I felt sorry for the way things had turned out for her. People don't like to feel sorry for individuals that have money.
Of course they don't, but right. I mean, she lost a lot of money on that.
She
probably
lost a lot of money.
And reputation.
She took a leap of faith, yeah, and reputation, and her husband's reputation, and, you know, and she was named in a lawsuit, right? Because somebody needed to be named that had the purse strings to pay for it. And so it's really, it's a shame because she was, I think, taken as much as anyone else.
So who got fucked with this that we don't know about? We know, obviously, the workers on site did not get paid, right? Or did they get paid anything?
The workers, I'm not sure. They might have gotten paid because most people were getting paid weekly or biweekly. Right, okay. So they might have gotten paid some. I think every single producer that basically wasn't paid, you know, the GoFundMe campaign that we did for Marianne ended up raising $250,000.
Unreal.
She was owed $55,000 or something like that. In debt and like $120,000 in revenue that was owed to her. So doubled that. I'm hoping that she'll take that extra proceeds and donate it to the second GoFundMe we created, which has now raised $50,000 for the day laborers.
Okay.
And hopefully, like, we want to get that up to $400,000 for security, for, you know, just any local staff, caterers.
Who started the GoFundMe campaigns?
The GoFundMe campaign was started by Marianne with Chris Smith, the director of the Netflix documentary, okay. And the first donation was made by the Fuck Jerry team.
Okay, interesting.
Yeah.
Marianne ran the bar.
Marianne ran a restaurant and fed all of us for the whole month leading up. She did lunch and dinner every day for the full production staff.
She's in the documentary. She's great.
She's in it. She's a wonderful
awesome.
Human. Yeah, I love her.
Who else got fucked that we don't know about?
I mean, Luca is like, it's really not articulated just how badly that guy got screwed. His equipment was his rented equipment was tied up for a month on the island. He had done everything right except for saying no. You know, his team worked countless hours to build up the stage and the site, and he was in the hole for a lot of money. And his reputation, his team was angry with him as well, right? Like, you know, you're the leader, you have to take that responsibility. And they were all frustrated.
One of the weirdest things about both documentaries is that I end it thinking, well, the festival ends and gets cancelled. So partway through each documentary, and I think, all right, Billy, you had great ambition, but you're an idiot. You're disorganized. You didn't have the ability to pull this off. You're out of your depth.
Mm-hmm.
Then we have this whole fake ticketing fiasco thing. Yeah. And I'm like, no, you're a fucking criminal.
Yeah.
You are a criminal, probably a sociopath.
Yeah.
And I just didn't understand. It was almost like he would do anything to maintain a certain standard of living.
Yeah. I mean, going back to after the festival, I had been under the radar. I got a call about a month later from Mike.com being like, we have these emails that were sent, which some of them are featured in the Netflix doc. Have your name on it. Just want a confirmation. Did you or did you not send these? And I said, well, you have my name. So of course, you know, I sent them. And they're like, well, can we get a comment? And I said, well, can we do this off the record? You know, I don't need my name associated with Fyre Festival. It's not really something that I care to have in the public. And they were like, sure, we'll do it off the record. So I give a quote. And then 2 months later, the head of production calls me and she's like, did you tell Mike.com they could use your name? And I'm like, of course not. She's like, me neither. But like, check it. This article got dropped. And so it has a quote from the email that I sent with Fyre Festival consultant Marc Weinstein. And so that's when I realized, okay, like, I'm now publicly associated with this. And I wanted to, and I was reflecting on it. And the reason I'm bringing this up is because I was reflecting often on, was Billy just someone that was out of his depths? You know, how much are we all just like Billy in some ways? And then, you know, to what extent did he cross the line? And I wrote this piece that I was going to publish with Mike. And then I realized, why am I publishing this with this group that released my name when they told me they wouldn't? And I just put it on Medium. And it's about honesty on social media. It's about basically if honesty could have saved Fyre Festival. And again, I had my own questions. Is Billy just the classic entrepreneur that's in over his head? And then 3 months later, I ended up recording the interview with Chris. Again, I was like, uncertain, should I do this, should I not? I saw Chris's previous documentary, which was called Jim and Andy, and I met Chris, and I was like, this guy is legit. If anyone's going to tell the story right, it's going to be him. And I had a massive amount of faith in him. And so the next day I went and I interviewed with him. And he said he told his girlfriend it was going to be a 30-minute interview. And we ended up speaking for 4 hours. It was kind of, it was more cathartic than this because it was the first time I spoke about it. But so Chris and I developed a relationship, and he showed me the first cut of the movie. And I was like, I'm in it way too much relative to how involved I was. I'd like to you to cut me out more. He's like, sure, sure. Didn't really. And then 2 months before, he's like, you have to see this footage I just got. You'll never believe it. And I went and I saw this footage that you're talking about. And I wasn't surprised, but it was just like, why did he want this filmed? He being Billy.
That's the other thing.
Like, he's crazy.
Why did he want it filmed?
He's crazy.
Well, that's why I put it down to some kind of like personality disorder, whereby, you know, if you research narcissism or sociopaths, attention, whether good or bad, is still attention, right?
Yeah.
And I think he likes the attention. But I still think you're a fucking criminal. You're a criminal. You have defrauded people. You have destroyed businesses. You've potentially ruined people's lives.
Yeah.
When you've crossed the line. You know, people try and create businesses and they're ambitious and things go wrong, right? And that does have a, chain reaction. But this, you know, wire fraud? I mean, what other crimes was he convicted of?
Well, so again, to the point of the investors being victims, he massively faked numbers. I mean, that's not even a question. The person that introduced me to him quoted a $20 million revenue number. There were two of the largest venture capital funds in the United States had submitted letters of intent to invest in this company because he faked numbers. The investors that put their money into the festival, which I think was a separate entity, were told that it would be backstopped by his Apple stock, which was worth $2.5 million or whatever he promised. But he forged the shares document, and really all he owned was like $1,000 worth of Apple. And so, you know, those were two things where he crossed the line. When you send fake wires, that's a federal offense. When you doctor documents, you know, for investment, that's fraud. And then, of course, you know, all of the marketing things that happened, without those two elements, you might ask, okay, well, he marketed something that was a dream that he thought he could pull off and he couldn't pull it off. But then you have to ask, did he ever really believe that he could give people what he promised them? When a private jet turns into a charter flight, when a private villa turns into a tent.
Yeah.
And you have to say no.
Well, it does come down to this honesty thing, right?
Yeah.
I know you've only been listening to my podcast for a short while, but I've always tried to operate with honesty, you know, honest interviews. I'm honest about my opinions. I run every part of what I do transparently. I even have these income reports on my website.
Yeah.
Just so if in the future, if anyone like accuses me of a certain bias or being, you know, I just always try and operate with honesty. And I think it works mainly for the good. You get some triggered people and you get some flack for being so transparent, but I think it mainly works for the good. And it was really interesting you brought up honesty there. And then you also mentioned it with regards to social media. So I do want to talk about Fuck Jerry.
Yeah.
Because sometimes I'm like, do they have a responsibility to the client of continuing the marketing? Or when they're aware of themselves, fully aware of themselves, do they then have a responsibility to turn around and say, no, we're not doing this because we're perpetuating a lie?
Yeah. I think, well, first... to honesty on social media, one of the ways I discovered you and your podcast was the tweet storm that you did.
Oh shit, that one.
Yeah.
Oh man, I regret that. Do you know what? Why? I regret most about that? No, I'm fully happy I did the tweet storm. It was the right thing to do at the time. People kept talking about the next bull run. I'd gone up and then I lost the money and it was painful and I made mistakes, but like, you know, it is what it is. I get 2% of trolls who turn around and go, who is this idiot? Why do you listen to his podcast? He lost $1 million. He's an idiot, right?
Yeah,
but I have had hundreds of DMs come to me and people saying, I'm the same,
exactly. But
the numbers are different. You know, one guy had gone up to 8 figures. So you're talking over $10 million, right?
Yeah. And lost a lot. Life-changing.
Yeah. I mean, it was life-changing for me, but so many people have gone through the same. So I'm glad I did it. I tell you what I'm not glad I did is the Guardian article. When they came to me and they said, we want to do a piece. And I said, look, I'm not really interested because I've been approached by the BBC, by Sky News. And I had a feeling it was going to be a hit piece. And I turned around to them and said, look, I will do it if it's not a hit piece. I want to talk about the positive side of Bitcoin because I believe in it. So we do the piece. I'm kind of agreeing on the article. And then they go out with this headline, how I lost $1 million on Bitcoin. It goes in on Facebook. I've got friends contacting me. Mm-hmm. I've got the comments are savage. It goes on Zero Hedge. The comments are brutal, like brutal. I just wish I hadn't done. I wish I hadn't done the press bit with it. I'm glad I did it, but yeah, that's interesting. You found me because of
well,
that.
Well, I mean, to that point, right? It's I even had concern about coming on your show. You know, like I've kind of moved on from this, and it's been 2 months since the documentary, and here I am, kind of sharing more stuff. You know, it's definitely hard. And exactly what you went through with that headline that happened to me with Mike.com, not to mention what's happening with these documentaries. I'm getting a really inside look at the way that the media machine works. You know, you're asking about Fuck Jerry. In my opinion, to some degree, the whole Fuck Jerry thing is because of the dueling Hulu Netflix fiasco, where Netflix pushed their release up ahead of Hulu's. Hulu rushed theirs out up ahead of Netflix, turned it into a feature from a series, and didn't have really anything except the Billy interview to go off of, and so needed someone, a new spin. And the entire power behind Hulu has been used to attack the Jerry Media team, who many of whom I don't think had really any clue what was happening with Fyre. They were going to attend, but they weren't the ones managing the account on the day-to-day. Like Elliot, as an example, who started Fuck Jerry, who is Fuck Jerry. I don't believe he worked on the Fyre account.
And I guess back to what you said earlier, festivals can be chaotic right up to the week before. So I guess they've got no idea. So that's interesting because I came out watching the Hulu one thinking,
they're the enemy.
Fuck Jerry.
Yeah, fuck Jerry.
You just took money. You perpetuated a fraud and now what you're saying to me is that they are just doing the job and they had no reason to know of the problem.
No, I haven't seen the Hulu doc, so I don't know what came out that might incriminate them further. I think two mistakes that they made. The first mistake they made was deleting comments, right? Like if you're a private individual and somebody's trolling you, you have every right to delete comments. But if it's a business and people are putting legitimate claims, like saying, hey, you know, this isn't, no one's contacting me, whatever, and they're sharing information with each other, deleting comments is a huge mistake. I think that's mistake number one. And then mistake number two is I really wished, and, you know, me, Mark, Andy, and a few others who agreed to do the Netflix documentary did so hoping that we could use it to repay some of what happened. And I really wish that at the end of that documentary, there had been a slide that said, proceeds from this documentary will be going back to repay workers in the Exumas. It doesn't have to be all the proceeds, but just some. And instead what happened was that never went on. And then a GoFundMe campaign was put together after all of this stuff. And maybe it was always the intention, but instead of it being direct from the proceeds of the documentary, now it's crowdfunded. And a lot of people are like, why aren't the models, why aren't Fuck Jerry, you know, pay, why aren't you, Mark? Because people think I'm rich or something from my Instagram account. I'm getting trolled comments like, why don't you, that place is nice, why don't you pay back the workers? You know, it's, you know, that's the mistake, the second mistake that was made. You know, I wish that it had been just proceeds from the doc or going to repay these people instead of a GoFundMe campaign. And had they done that, they would have been bulletproof. You know, like it would have been like, obviously these guys did it for the right reason. And instead, now it feels like it was something that was done after all of this controversy kicked up.
Yeah.
And even though the result's the same.
Well, and you talk about the media machine, and it's really interesting as well. So I'm starting to get exposure from the media machine from two different directions. My own exposure just to one little story. It's totally irrelevant in the grand scheme of life, but experiencing being manipulated and experiencing the reaction to a story, okay? To the point now, I don't think I would ever want to do something like that ever again. But I'm also seeing it the other side as a media creator. I get challenged. I get told I'm a journalist, at... So a lot of people want to tell me how I should do my job quite regularly. And they tell me I'm a journalist, so I have certain ethical responsibilities. And I don't consider myself a journalist. I've never been trained. I don't know how to do it. But I also get a number of false accusations about my intentions. Just all the time. And it's really interesting to see there is pressure from the media and pressure to the media. And I'd never considered either in detail until now.
Yeah. I mean, there's always going to be people that don't agree with what you're doing.
Yeah.
Right? And like I opened up my Instagram account after the festival because the followers were pouring in, and I decided that there was a little platform here and there was something that I can do with it, which I'm still working on. I think I told you I'm starting my own podcast, and you know, there are certain messages that I think I would like to share. Whether, you know, my experience warrants that or not, I don't know, but it gave me this silly little platform, and there's been a lot of hate comments on it. You know, a lot of people just trolling me and saying, you know, just really nasty things. But the reality is, like, I don't know those people, you know, like there's always going to be people that hate, and you just have to trust that you're doing the right thing and keep doing your job. And I mean, when we were going to interview, I listened to a few episodes of your podcast, recent episodes, and really enjoyed them. You know, you had Andreas Antonopoulos on, you had Bill Barhight on, you have real people coming on this show. You know, like I said, I'm probably one of the least real in this space that you've interviewed.
Of the most real interviews, I've got to be honest. I think it's going to be interesting, the reaction, because sometimes I want to step out of Bitcoin, right?
Yeah.
Just occasionally for a story, whether it's crypto or not. So I'm doing a bunch of stuff on Lightning, and I wanted to get the most opposed to Lightning person I could, or somebody would really challenge me in a way I didn't expect. And I asked this guy, Peter Risen, the fallout's been awful, truly awful. People won't stop talking about it and attacking me, and I've got to the point now where if I do the interview, I get attacked by Bitcoiners. If I don't do the interview, I get attacked by Bitcoin cashers for cracking under the pressure of maximalists. It's a lose-lose situation. I can't win it.
Yeah.
And then yesterday I had the opportunity to go Spank Chain, and like, I've got no real interest in the Spank Chain token. I don't like the fact they did an ICO. I've told you I'm not a big fan of ICOs.
Yeah.
It took me a while to learn that, by the way. And now I'm getting attacked for that, telling I'm a shill. And it's really difficult because I want to push the bounds of what I do, but every time I do, there's more and more people attacking.
Yeah, but I mean, a couple things on Spank Chain. Not that I'm a shill, and full disclosure, I don't own any Spank, and I don't know if the token will have value over time. But, you know, two of the number one use cases for crypto are banking the unbanked and removing centralized parties that extract more value than they create. And if you look at the life of these cam girls, they can't get banked, right? So they don't have access to traditional financial services. And these centralized cam sites take 50% of their fees in some instances. So like, the intention behind that makes sense to me, right?
Yeah.
And like, the use case for crypto actually seems relevant here. Now, maybe it should just be Bitcoin, right? And that's what people are trying to say. But, and then you have Amin, who, you know, and this team who shipped one of the first layer two scaling solutions to be built on top of Ethereum, right? And now he's doing his work with Malik Dao. And so I hold that team in really high regard. And so, of course, so people are going to attack you because they did an ICO. Okay. But at the time, maybe there were individuals that were always like, ICOs are bad. But there was also a lot of talk, even in traditional circles, that ICOs were a replacement for a traditional venture funding model and were democratizing access to early stage companies. And I still think that there's some truth to that statement, right? Like, why is it that only VCs have access to the best deals? What if you could actually crowdfund? Now, security, utility, you know, it's clear that if you're raising capital, you don't have a working product, you're not truly decentralized. This is a security.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that was the promise of crowdfunding, was like, why can only someone with $250,000 a year in income, I think that's the number, it might be 200, and $2 million in net worth, why does that mean they're sophisticated and only they can invest in deals? Why is it money begetting money rather than, oh, I actually understand crypto, I've been researching this for 2 years, let me answer a questionnaire to decide whether or not I should be able to invest in this. I'm a sophisticated investor. And that was the promise of ICOs. But now, in hindsight, yeah, of course, whenever there's money to be made, there's scam artists that come along and take advantage. But like, I don't think something in and of itself is good or bad.
Well, when ICOs first hit, I didn't day one think, oh, look at these ICOs, they're all scams. I thought, oh, this is an opportunity to invest. And it's only with time and with hindsight I started to learn, okay, they're not so great.
Yeah.
I'm a huge sympathizer to the views of maximalists, you know, especially those who've been around for the early days, you know, 2010 through 2011. They've watched repeated projects come and go. So they're pretty hardened now to the fact that most of these blockchain-based things are stupid and dumb. I just find it very hard to go full maximalist, everything's bullshit. I feel like I just need to have a look at some things. And, you know, the guy at SpankChain made a couple of points that I thought were interesting. You know, we discussed Bitcoin. They want to do micropayments. Bitcoin can't really do micropayments to the level that maybe they want to do. Now, some people argue you can. Mm. I'm just saying to the level they want. Then Bitcoiners may come out and say, well, Lightning Network. But Lightning Network isn't ready yet, and there's some problems with it, and it might be a year, 2 years. So I feel like I do want to look at it. And look, if it turns...
What about volatility?
Well, that was the other question. Right?
And these girls can't get banked.
Yeah.
So... How are they going to convert the Bitcoin into fiat, and should they have to deal with the volatility in the underlying asset, which is why stablecoins were created?
Well, so that was part of the conversation, because the booty coin.
And booty.
I did struggle to not laugh during the conversation.
I think you could laugh. I think they're serious about their tech, but they don't care about their branding. Their branding and marketing is supposed to be kitschy.
But like... I've always thought, well, for a long time, I've thought almost every single utility token should be a stablecoin.
Mm.
Not that they should exist, but if they are going to exist, they should be a stablecoin, because you don't need price volatility with something. You wouldn't want to go around a supermarket, and as you're going around filling up your shopping basket, things start changing price, right?
Exactly.
You want to know, I've earned this much dollar, it can buy me this much stuff. So we talked about that, and they do have a stablecoin because the sex workers, you know, they don't want to have volatility in the price, right?
Yeah.
That makes total sense. So again, whether or not the tech is right, I'm not smart enough technically to know whether the tech is right, and I can't get into that. That's not who I am.
You are.
No, I'm more about the story and the people. But when I was talking about him, he was bringing up issues that I think are relevant. And if, because of that interview, that makes people more aware of issues for sex workers, and maybe inspire someone to go and do a Bitcoin, a version of what they're doing, then great. But I think it's myopic to close off any debate because you think there's potentially a scammy element there, because my job is not going in there to shill SpankChain.
Well, this is the main issue with our industry right now, is that anything that people disagree with turns into a scam or someone shilling. And there's not a lot of room for discourse, for reasonable discussion. I mean, there are people that are having serious conversations, but, you know, just take Bitcoin versus Bitcoin Cash as a prime example, right? There are individuals that I've met in the last year in this space who have told me, I've sold all of my Bitcoin. And, you know, they've been in it since the beginning. And they're bullish on Bitcoin Cash. And if you ask them why, they say, I didn't sign up for digital gold. I signed up for peer-to-peer eCash. And like, and who am I to argue with these individuals who have way more experience than I do? Now, there are some questions that I have, you know, who's benefiting the most? Is it the miners, et cetera? But maximalism in any form, anywhere, I think is a red flag because it shows a lack of a desire for continued learning. And I think that if Satoshi were a real person, he or she would not be a maximalist.
That's a brave statement.
Yeah, I know.
I mean, you know, in doing the podcast, what I do, I mean, you're going
to
do a podcast. We should talk about that.
Yeah, I would love
any
to.
Way I can help you out, you let me know. I've
Thank
got
you.
Your back. But in doing the podcast, I don't just turn up and meet anyone and just switch the button on and record. I'm always thinking of what I want to learn and the direction I want to go. And I took myself right to the edge of maximalism. Like the peak maximalism point I did was I put out a tweet at one point that said, I think it was Bitcoin maximalism is common sense. So I'd taken myself right to the limit, done as many interviews as I could. Interestingly, the first response was from Eric Voorhees, who I'm going to interview in 2 days.
He's awesome.
I'm sure, yeah, he is awesome. In some ways, there's some things he's done I don't like, but I'm looking forward to having the discussion with him about it. I think it's I think open discourse is great. I don't appreciate the people coming and almost bullying me to the point of making me fear what interviews I should do, because there are things that I think need discussing. Like with Bitcoin Cash, right?
By the way, they can opt out of listening.
Oh, of course, of course. But no, but the argument is I'm given a platform to scammers.
Yeah.
And therefore given a voice to proven scammers.
This is an argument that, you know, Jack Dorsey was just on the Joe Rogan show twice because of this exact argument. You know, how platforms and media are used to promote bad ideas, right? Where does policing come into play? Like, these are questions that you and I don't have the answers to.
Well, you can't draw a line. I interviewed Andrew Torba from Gab.com. Not a very popular guy.
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of...
Not familiar with him.
Well, he's got a platform that's like Twitter. They've been deplatformed on everything for, you know, freedom of speech, like allowing people to just talk about anything. And I've been on the platform, and some of the stuff on there is just disgusting, and the things, it's not to my taste. Yeah. But his view is, like, let ideas out, because where do you draw the line? Okay. Yeah. So, you know... Say with Bitcoin Cash, I don't like the fact it's called Bitcoin Cash. I don't like the fact it has a leader. I think there was something in there that said, I would be interested to learn what bigger blocks mean. Yeah, I just am. I don't know why, I just am. Don't do all these scammy things. Don't attack Bitcoin. That would have been interesting for me to learn, but just do it as a separate fork with a different name. But I wanted to sometime talk to these people. I want the full range of information. And it's really, really hard when people start pressuring you or they start sending out tweets, copying in your sponsors, which is your line of income, saying, why are you sponsoring this podcast? Or they're bullying you, or they're telling you you've got no reputation, or they're telling you you've got no integrity. I mean, it's really rough.
Yeah, it hurts. I mean, you know, you're just a person and we're all just people. So this stuff really does cause pain, you know, and I think all we can do is ignore it. I mean, you obviously love Bitcoin, right?
Yeah,
like
I'm
you're
a
here for a reason. I too am a Bitcoiner. Like I discovered Bitcoin, non-sovereign, censorship resistant, sound money. You know, yes, please. Where can I get more of that? And I think most of us got here because of that. And as the market comes down, I think most people kind of revert back to being Bitcoin maximalists or holding more Bitcoin as a percentage of their portfolio because it's been proven to this extent that it works. But like, that's the point. The point is there's always these extremes, you know, and you can't do anything about the trolls. They're going to come after you no matter what. You cannot win. There is always going to be someone that disagrees with you. I think one of the problems is we don't have real... Twitter is not a platform for dialogue. It's a platform for simultaneous monologues. Right. And so we all talk at each other, but nobody's really conversing. And then you meet someone in person and you're like, oh, wow, I really like this guy or girl, you know, and what they have to say is interesting. And, oh, I learned from them. And people are more willing behind closed doors to kind of change position.
I've just started blocking people now. I've just got to the point where it's too exhausting.
And you reserve the right to block them.
Yeah, but it starts to affect you mentally and physically.
Yeah.
So it got to the point where I was stressing over things, wasn't able to sleep properly and worrying. I'm thinking, I'm just trying to produce some content here.
Yeah, like, you're just doing your job.
This pressure is too much. So yeah, I've started blocking people now. And like anyone I have blocked, by the way, they can always come back to me and say, look, okay, let's talk about this. Mm-hmm. Let's be civil. I respect you. You respect me. And I will always unblock. I've unblocked some people recently. But
yeah, but when they start attacking your character.
Yeah, over and over. And then, you know, there's like mob mentality or groups of people starting to get together. It's just, yeah, it's too much.
It's painful. And, you know, that's the world that we live. Like one of the problems with the world that we live in today and one of the things that I talk about and plan to talk about on my podcast, I'm interviewing some people that are trying to change social media in general. You know, the fact that from across the world at any given moment in time, if you're on your social media, your mood can be completely shifted by, you know, by a text, by a tweet, by a Facebook post, by an email, right? No one ever had to live with that before,
mm-hmm.
right? You could just be going about your day to day, open up your phone, and all of a sudden, you know, your whole day has changed for the worst. And people, you know, I think truth... number one, I think compassion number two, and that's fully lacking on social. It's fully lacking. It's so easy to be a troll when you're sitting behind a computer screen, but when you have to look someone in the eye and talk to them, it's just like, it's a different experience.
Well, I had to do it myself a few times. I've had to apologize to people because, you know, look, I'm saying this. I've been a dick myself sometimes, like on plenty occasions.
Yeah.
You know, I think
we all have.
Yeah, I guess so. And yeah. All right. So tell me about this podcast, man.
Yeah. So I don't know. I mean, I'm just kind of rolling with it. I've started posting a lot about, ironically, on social media about social media, but kind of meeting people where they are. I'm a really big fan of what's called the digital wellness movement or the humane tech movement, which is, you know, again, when these devices were put into our pockets and, you know, the internet kind of took off and mobile internet took off. I don't know that the intention was what we have today with these social platforms. And so now more than ever, we have an attention economy where our phones control us more than we control them. And there's a lot of companies and individuals that are starting to raise awareness for that. Tristan Harris being one of them with the Center for Humane Tech. And it might seem like a small thing, but it really, it has ripple effects across everything from like politics and government through mental health and what you're describing. And so, you know, the podcast will start talking about that issue. And then I'd like to talk about other issues by highlighting people that are on the front line solving them that face, I guess, millennials specifically. You know, the opioid crisis in the United States might be one thing that I would talk about.
Is that Oxy?
Yeah.
Yeah, I've heard a lot about that.
I grew up on Long Island and I've known probably personally like three or four people that have died from heroin overdoses. You know, and it's real, right? And we talk about, you know, another theme that keeps arising is psychedelics and their use for you know, treatment of mental disorders, PTSD. MDMA is in phase 3 trials for PTSD treatment right now,
right,
for soldiers. So that could be an interesting topic. But
how far are you away from getting this live then?
Oh, I mean, I've recorded 2 episodes. I've got my third episode tonight. I want to get like a head start because I want to do what you do, which is like one per week. I've got 10 people lined up, but you know, we're here in person and this is so much better, I think, than like a video. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to ask you after this, like, how you deal with kind of video chatting.
Yeah. I mean, I do it on this. Somebody else might want to hear and listen to it. Yeah. I prefer in person. I would do every single one in person if I could. And there are certain ones I have to do in person. Like I knew I had to meet you in person because I knew there would be a lot of emotion with what you went through. And I just had to get a feel for you that this would not have worked over Skype for me. When I got the opportunity for Hester Peirce at the SEC, I knew that had to be in person. Mark Carr Palace, Mount Gox, had to do it in person. So there's certain ones I have to do in person because, you know, I had this debate with somebody recently who was criticizing my podcast and said, you've only got sponsors to pay for your travel budget, blah, blah, blah. You don't need to travel. The content's the same, whatever. And it's just factually wrong.
Mm.
You know, that 10, 15 minutes before we record, I get a feel for who you are as a person by your hospitality, the questions you ask. By being with you, I'm not looking at you through a lens. I'm looking at you with a full peripheral vision, and I see your arm movements, or I see your face move. And in my interviews in person, I think are infinitely better than the others, although I do get some great ones over Skype.
Mm.
So I
well,
would
how, do you, how do you balance, you know, trying to get one a week?
Two a week.
Two a week.
Two a week.
Oh, wow.
So, and I have to balance that with the
machine.
Fact, yeah. Well, I have to balance that with the fact that I'm a single dad and who's going to look after my child as well. So I tend to just, when I travel, I do as many as I can in a small amount of time to get them recorded, get them batched out. And then I'll, in between travel, I'll record them remotely. But if a special one comes up and I know I have to do it in person, I will find a way to do that in person. I'll find the way to cover the cost or find the way to, I'll just find a way. You're here in LA. I'm in Bedford. There is nobody to interview into Bedford. Occasionally we get people come through London, which is great. But you're in LA. You know, there are plenty of people around here you can speak
absolutely.
To.
It's a great community out here as well.
So when do you think you'll go live?
I think that I'll go live in 2 weeks. So I'm going to try to have a head start of 4 weeks of content. I've got 2 interviews this weekend. I've got 1 tonight. So I'll have 5 weeks, which is great. And I was told just put it out there. So it's going to be raw, unedited, just dialogue with people that I think are interesting, working on the front lines, solving some of these challenges. First interviews with this guy, Andrew Murray Dunn, who created an open source platform for Android. That's a new operating system for your phone. And the whole point is that, you get to take back control of your phone, not the other way around. And I love that. So I'm excited about Andrew and his story, and hopefully I can keep getting more content. And honestly, like, it'll either resonate with people or it won't. It's probably not for your audience. Maybe there's some overlap, but I don't know. We'll see. We'll see what happens.
And how can I help you?
Oh, good question. Well, I definitely will want to learn more about like editing after the fact, or sound, or what equipment I need, or, you know, keeping it at a certain length. The second interview I did went to 2 hours, and I feel like that's going to be boring for people. So,
well, we've gone to 2 hours here, but I think this, I'm happy for this one. This is different. Telling. Yeah.
Well, hopefully people find it interesting, but maybe they won't.
How are you feeling, man?
A little bit stressed, honestly. A little bit tense going back through that. This will be the last one that I do on Fyre.
Right.
For sure. I'm over it. I'm like excited and onto new greener pastures, and you know, the crypto world is just the best, honestly.
Do you feel like you've told the story in a different way than previously? Is this something new?
Yeah, I mean, definitely. I'm sure new things will come out for people that they didn't realize had happened. You know, I think I covered a lot of this for the documentary, but again, they have to weave a story in a documentary, so most of this gets cut out.
Okay. Yeah. What else you got coming up?
What do I have coming up? Man, Penn Blockchain Conference. Excited about that. I think people, you know, institutional capital is moving into the space in a meaningful way. I think deals are getting better. Just more of this, right? It's just like I think we're in the right place still, in spite of like 90% price declines or whatever.
And how can people keep an eye on you? How can they stay in touch?
I'm hesitant to put my Twitter because it's going to get trolled, but it's just Warc Meinstein, WARCMEINSTEIN. Twitter for mostly crypto things, some other ideas. Instagram is where you can find, same handle. You can find other types of content. The podcast will mostly be from Instagram. Yeah, that's it. Oh, and I work at a place called Wave Financial, wavegp.com. We invest in crypto projects. We're trying to bridge the gap for institutions to invest into the industry. If you're a Bitcoin maximalist, there's going to be nothing better than institutional capital pouring into Bitcoin. So yeah, that's kind of what we're focused on.
All right, man. Well, this was my first outdoor interview.
It was fun. No, isn't it nice out here?
Yeah, I'll be interested to hear it back.
Yeah.
We'll have to cut the helicopter out, but there was a dog yapping at the start. Yeah. You know, it was really cool, man. So
it's
thank
cool.
you.
No
really
problem.
Appreciate time. Appreciate you being candid. Appreciate you opening up.
Yeah, thanks for inviting me on. Maybe next time we can talk about, you'll invite me back for the merits of my work.
The merits of your Bitcoin work.
Yeah.
All right, man. Look, take care. I wish you all the best with everything you do.
Thank you.
Okay, so how was that? Pretty crazy, right? Like I said, if you haven't watched either documentary, I recommend you checking them out. They're both different as well. I kind of felt like you need to see both. They look at the story from kind of two different directions. And this interview highlighted why I like to do a lot of my interviews in person, because sometimes you really need to see the body language or the facial expressions right in front of you. And I could see the stress going over Mark as he was talking about this. Is obviously quite a traumatic thing to go through, but it was really great for him to do this and let me do the interview. As he said to me afterwards, he now just wants to move on from this. He just wants to get on with the next chapter in his life, and I wish him all the best in everything he does. Mark is definitely one of the good guys. I'm looking forward to hanging out with him again in the future, and yeah, probably will become a close mate of mine. He's a really, really good guy. And sorry that most of this was off topic. Sometimes there are opportunities to do interviews that I think are worth doing, and yeah, as ever, I value your feedback. Feel free to reach out to me. My email address is hello@whatbitcoindid.com. And that was a really long interview, so I'm just going to rattle through how you can support the show. Look, it's all on my website. Just go to www.whatbitcoindid.com, click on the support section, but basically listen to the ads. If you don't want the ads, you can become a patron at patreon.com/whatbitcoindid. If you don't want to do that, you can subscribe by crypto. Just reach out to me. I'll give you a deposit address, and then I'll add you to the distribution list. You can send me a tip. You can become a sponsor. Email me on hello@whatbitcoindid.com if you're interested in that. You can leave me a review on iTunes. You can subscribe. You can follow me on social media. You can check out my website, sign up to my newsletter, or just share the show out with your friends and family. Anything you do helps the show, and I really, really do appreciate all the support. As I mentioned earlier, I'm off to Denver tomorrow. then to Austin, New York, and then I'll be heading back home to the UK. It's been an epic trip. Thank you so much to everyone who has helped me, to everyone who's met up with me, everyone who's supported what I've done. And yeah, I'm just missing my kids. So I want to get back home. Looking forward to that. But also, I will have some great interviews coming up for you through the rest of the month. And remember, if you want to reach out to me, my email address is hello@whatbitcoindid.com.